Jesus, you're my King.
Your life frees me to sing.
Your life frees me to sing.
I will praise you all my days.
I'll praise you all my days.
You're perfect in all your ways. Jesus, you're my Lord.
Hail Jesus, you're my Lord.
I will obey your word.
I will obey your word.
I want to see your kingdom come.
I want to see your kingdom come.
Not my will, but yours be done.
Not my will, but yours be done.
Glory, glory to the Lamb.
Glory, glory to the Lamb.
You take me into the Lamb.
we love fellowship, praise God, because we're a family church, right? It's like a little reunion every time we get together. We should be happy to be in the house of the Lord. Miss Linda's got a little something to share. Okay? She's going to share with us just a minute, and then Thomas is going to bring our message, and we're going to have a good time in the Lord.
It's a couple of weeks ago before the ministry began to take the turn toward the supernatural once again, you know, the moving of the Spirit and the spontaneity of the Spirit. I was sitting on the couch, and I had the night before Pastor John preached on that, I was sitting there, and the Lord said the word growth spurt. And, you know, a growth spurt is when a child or a teenager or whatever takes this sudden acceleration in growth where they grow upward and sometimes a little outward, and they begin to take on characteristics of the more mature. And I came in, and I heard the word on the supernatural and beginning to move in the spontaneity of the Spirit, you know, having the balance between the concreteness of the word, the solid part of the word, and the spontaneity of the Spirit. And the Lord said, I want to create a growth spurt in the people. And the reason I'm giving the word is to create an expectation in you to receive that. Be open to that. Be open to an acceleration in growth all of a sudden. And I was standing back there during worship, and I just kept hearing the Lord say the word restore. 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 He wants to restore our souls. He wants to restore the balance of the concreteness of the word and the spontaneity of the Spirit, but he also wants to restore the things that he has given us in Christ. He wants us to come to an awareness of those things that he has given and to restore our souls to that place. So I simply prayed. I said, Lord, restore me. Restore my awareness of the presence of God in me and restore this balance to the church that we need. We need all of that. So I just heard that word over and over and over. And there was a place in Isaiah 42, it says, none said restore. But I say restore. Restore. The Lord says restore. He wants to restore our souls. He wants to restore us. And he wants to restore all of that back to the church, to the place where we are moving and flowing in both avenues of that. And it bringing a wholeness to the gospel.
Amen. You may be seated. Praise the Lord. I tell you what, there is, I've been thinking about this, and just it's just roaring in my spirit. Rightly dividing the word of truth. And there is such a lack of that today in the church world. I'm not talking about the world. I'm talking about in the body, so-called, I hate to even say the body of Christ, but in the church world, it is the body of Christ. But man, we need to divide the word of truth and know, man, know what the truth says, what the word says, not what mom and them says. You know, I heard a lady last night, she said, you know, my daddy said a lot of things, a lot of quotes, but they wasn't out of the Bible. I don't know where he got them from. Sometimes we have a hard time to decide, is that the word or is that just something somebody said? You know, we get a little messed up on that sometimes. But I believe that God is restoring us to His truth, and that we're going to hunger for the truth and the Word of God. You know, you only go after those things that you hunger for. I'm about to get into my message before I get into it. But Anyhow, I just thank God for His. I thank God for you. I thank God for this church, this body, that we can just come together and worship the Lord and just see the glory of God manifest in our midst and have wasn't that an awesome meeting we had last weekend? That was powerful. I tell you, I don't know what happened Sunday night, but I don't know if anybody else felt it, but I sure did. There was just a deep stirring in my spirit. It wasn't about the preacher. It wasn't about the singing. It was about God. You know, God was just doing something in us. I had a great time singing too. We had a great time of worship and praise, and it was a joy to have Simeon here with us. And I loved all that, but it wasn't about that. Brother Mark, he always does a great job. I love the man. I love his delivery, and I respect him. But it wasn't about him. It was just about God. I don't know how else to describe it, but I'm thankful today that for this body and that we can come together and receive directly from the Father. We're learning to do that. You know, Pastor John, he feeds us and gives us the Word, but sometimes we just need a download from the Father. Amen? And I think we're getting to the point to where we're allowing that to happen more and more, and that's what causes a growth spurt. Amen? When we just enjoy His presence. Let me get into this. Turn with me in your Bibles to Genesis 1 and 2. Genesis chapter 1, verse 2. I'm waiting on the shuffling of pages. Sometimes we go in churches, and these millennial churches, they don't have many shuffling of pages, which I don't have myself. But it's hard to know when they're there. But are you there? Amen. And the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep. Amen. The earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep. Now, I'm not going to get deep with you today on this. There's a lot of study on the creation of God, and I just believe that He did it. I don't care how He did it. I just believe He did it. Some people say, well, it was the Big Bang Theory. No, it was this or that. He did it. Amen. He did it. Amen. When God began to fill this earth, you know, I was reading this and at first I was thinking, oh, you know, about the beautiful hills, and we have the rolling hills here in South Carolina. More so as you get over closer to where I live. This is a little more flat land, but not quite as much as you get down to the east and south up here. You get in that sandy area, and then you get on down to the beach and the coastal lines. But it said that there were the fields were not growing. They didn't have plants growing in them out in the fields because it had not rained at that time. Everything that was there was watered by the dew coming up from the ground. It had never rained until the time of Noah. But God created the garden, and He put Adam and Eve in there. He created man. And let's read and turn over to the second chapter there, in the second verse, seventh verse, and it says, "And the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground, and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul." When God breathed on man, that's when that psuche, that breath of God came into him, that's when we became a living soul. And, you know, even though we're created until God breathes on us. That's why sometimes I come in here and I say, just breathe on us, Lord. Breathe on us today, God. You know, this is not in my message here, but just a little side note. If you take a fire that's just about to go out, and all you can see really is a little smoke and some embers there that, you know, it's just a little charcoal looking. When you begin to breathe on it, have you ever watched Survivor? They'll get that flint and they'll strike it, and you know, they never made fire before maybe, but they get down there and they get a little spark and they get the... When we get a little about to go out, when our fire just about goes out, all we need is a breath of God to... And all of a sudden that leaps, and that fire just leaps up within us. And you know, sometimes we just need the fire of God to leap within us. You know, when fire gets around, it creates a thirsting and a hunger. You know, you can't be around fire without it doing something to you. It either make you hot or make you run, or it'll make you thirsty. Lord have mercy. I'm just rambling here, but I love the fire of God, and I love the breath of God to breathe. We used to sing a song, breathe on me, Jesus. Let me feel your mighty power. Breathe on me, Jesus. Send your spirit this very hour. Like a rushing mighty wind, restore my soul again. Breathe on me, Spirit of the Lord. I want God to breathe on you today. You know, I don't care if you're so on fire. You know, still, when you take a fire that's burning bright a breath of wind comes by, man, you better let it out. Somebody else might get caught on fire, you know. I want God to set a fire down in our soul that we can't contain and we can't control. You say, well, you asking for wildfire? No, I don't want wildfire, because wildfire just goes crazy. But I want God's fire. Amen. Now, don't worry about wildfire. If there's enough wet blankets around. I'm moving right along here. God made man spirit, soul, and body. He also gave him a will to be able to make choices. You know, God wants us to choose. He said, choose you this day whom you will serve. I believe there was a void in man that God left. Something that calls us to reach out to God. You know, a hunger in us that would cause us, a thirsting in us that would cause us to reach out to Him. And you know, sometimes when you get a little sick, you don't have much of an appetite. And you know, I looked at Reese today and I said, you know, she just went down running around playing like she normally does. And I said, she just don't feel real good today, does she? You know, sometimes you get to that point, you don't want fire, you don't want nothing to drink, you don't want nothing to eat. God comes in and does a healing in us and creates that hunger again. I pray God do a healing across His body, healing to our spirit, our soul, our mind, that we'll have a hunger in us for the Word of God and the washing of the Word and the water of the Spirit, that will have a hunger in us again. And I believe that God allowed us to have this in us. Genesis, the third chapter. We're going to move right on. We're going to preach the whole Bible today. Amen. Third chapter, verse 1-5 says, the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field which the Lord had made. And he said unto the woman, Yea, hath God said, Ye shall not eat of every tree of the garden? And the woman said unto the serpent, that was her first mistake. Well, her first mistake, she listened to him. Then the second mistake, she talked to him. The woman said unto the serpent, We may eat of the fruit of the tree of the garden. But of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God hath said, here was her third mistake, Ye shall not eat of it. She begins to add to, Neither shall ye touch it. That ain't what God said. Lest ye die. He didn't say that either. So when we start adding to what God says, gets tainted. That goes back to what we started with, rightly dividing the word of truth. God speaks the truth. We have the word of God that is truth. But when we add to it, or when we give our perspective of it, I believe that's something that Brother Mark, wasn't that Brother Mark said something about that Saturday night, I think it was, Brother Sanchez. But you shall not eat of it, neither shall you touch it, lest ye die. And the serpent said unto the woman, You shall not surely die. For God doth know that in the day ye eat thereof, then your eyes shall be open, and you shall be as gods, knowing good and evil. Pride of life begins to take over. And, you know, now that we know that they took of that fruit and we're cursed with knowing good and evil. Amen? The sin nature, we know good and we know evil. So now we have to choose between good and evil. Amen? And it's our responsibility. You say, Oh God, don't let me do nothing wrong. How dumb is that? Yeah, we need His strength. Yes, we do need the strength of the Word in us. But, you know, Pastor John talks about Peter when he walked on the water. The storm got in Peter and he began to sink. It's Jesus walked on the water because the storm wasn't in him. You know, if we get full of the Word, the storm ain't going to get in us. Well, there ain't going to be no room for the storm. Amen. If we get full of the Word, then let the Word of God be so full in us. Amen. It's one thing to get full of the Word, but to let it be full in us. Amen. Let's move on. We got to get on down the road here. Eve had a hunger, not just for food, but for more knowledge. She was tempted. She had a will to choose whether she would or would not eat the fruit. But she was deceived by the deceiver, the master deceiver. That's what he does. He deceives, he lies, and he tells you something that may sound like the truth, but that's why it's so important to know the truth. You know, I remember when Jesus was in the wilderness there, or he was up on the mountain, and Jesus, the devil took to him, looked at him, said, Oh, serve me and I'll give you all of this. And he said, Get thee behind me, Satan. He even quoted part of the 91st Psalm to him. That made me mad at the devil for doing it, because I love that 91st Psalm. You know, does it not say that you should mount up on wings and no deadly thing can harm you? You know, just you got to know where to put, when to put, sometimes just your mind, your thoughts into place and say, No, that's not the way it is. The Word says this. But because of Eve's hunger and her deception, she partook of the fruit, and we've been paying for it ever since. Well, we didn't pay for it. Jesus paid for it. Amen. Took the life of the only begotten Son of the Father to pay for that sin, that betrayal of the Father. Because Adam and Eve have the knowledge of good and evil. Then in Judges, the 16th chapter, you don't have to turn there. I'm not going to read it. But you know the story of Samson, how he was so strong in the Lord, but his desire got the best of him. He desired Delilah. You know, I'm talking about the void that is in us, that there's things, desire for knowledge, desire for whatever. You know, we have all these desires going on in us, this emptiness in us, and we try to fill it with knowledge. We try to fill it with sex. We try to fill it with alcohol or drugs or just pleasures of life. Just going out and party, party, party. You know, I can't get enough partying. You know, I want to dance the night away, you know. and that's not fulfilling. It always leaves you emptier than, I'm not saying that there's not pleasure for a season. You know, there's pleasure in sin and in the things of the world, but it's only for a season. Then that fades away and you're left in worse shape. You know, I've heard people, I've never been one to do the party scene. I guess you would call me whatever you wanted to call me, because I didn't do that scene, but heard people talk about, you know, after partying all night and having a great time, and then they go hug the throne, you know, the toilet, and do their thing for. That don't seem like fun to me. That just doesn't seem like fun to me. I don't know. I guess maybe I am a prude or something. I don't. But anyhow, I heard this quote, and I wish I could tell you where I heard it, but it's not the meat in the trap that lures us, but the hunger in our heart. You know, there's a trap that Satan set for every one of us, and he will try to lure you away from the truth. He will try to get you off of the path that God is, you know, Jeremiah, I know the plans I have for you, you know. God wants good things for us, but the enemy of our soul comes along and tries to distract us or dissuade us or tries to deceive us or tries to cause us to hunger after things that we don't even need. That's not fulfilling anyhow. And he comes and he tries to steal, kill, and destroy. And sometimes we let him. Well, glory. But it's not the meat in the trap that lures us, but the hunger in our heart. Pastor John would say, it's a matter of the heart. It's a problem with the heart. You know, we need to get our heart right. It doesn't do any good to have our head right, to have a knowledge of the Word, unless we get our heart right. It has to be a head change and let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. But also there has to be a heart change. And I just believe that God allowed this void in us, that it wouldn't be fulfilled with the pleasures of life, but it would cause us to seek after something that is beyond us. You know, to not just try to fulfill it with the things of this world, but to seek after God and to seek after the things of the Bible and the things of the Spirit, the fruit of the Spirit, and to be filled with that to the point that we desire nothing but that and that alone. Because once you've tasted, like we did this past weekend. Once you taste of that, oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Once you've tasted of the goodness of God and the pleasures of His right hand, it said, His pleasures of His right hand, Thou wilt show me. Psalm 16 and 11, Thou wilt show me the path of life. In His presence, there's fullness of joy. And at His right hand, pleasures forevermore. Evermore. What are we looking for? What are you looking for today? Pleasures forevermore. I want Jesus. I want Jesus. I want Jesus. Nothing else can satisfy me like Jesus. No one ever cared for me like Jesus. I love my wife and she loves me, but she can't love me like Jesus. Can't nobody do me like Jesus. Nobody. Nobody greater. Nobody greater than Him. I found in Him a friend so kind and true. I found that He is my rock when I need stabilizing. He's my rock I can stand on. I found in Him the joy that is unspeakable and full of glory. And the half hasn't even begun to be told yet. I found that He's the great I am. He's the Lord God Almighty. He's the righteous King. He's the bread and the living water. He is the great one. Nobody like Jesus. Nobody. Can't nothing do me like Jesus. Can't nothing satisfy me like Jesus. I don't want the world. I don't want the things of the world. Give me Jesus. I want Him to be fresh in me today. I want Him to be new in me today. I want Him to be so alive in me today that nothing else matters. Oh, I may not have quite the money I want in the bank, but it don't matter because I got Jesus. I may not have the car that I'd like to drive, but it don't matter because I got Jesus. Jesus in me. Jesus on me. Jesus around me. I got Him and He's got me. Greater is He that is in me than he that is in the world. It's amazing what you do when the Holy Ghost comes on you. I believe I'm feeling a little better. We started rehearsing in here today and I got so weak I couldn't stand up. I was checking the sound out and I said, I believe I'm going to sit down over here. I'm feeling a little better. He's my healer, my baptizer. He's my King of Kings and Lord of Lords. We need to just play that video, Lord. I'm kidding. But He is everything you need Him to be at the very moment you need it the most. And we are a needy people. We need things from time to time. But Jesus said, I'm enough. I know, and when you... Like I said before, when you're not feeling quite like you ought to or like you'd want to, it's hard to get excited about a preacher getting up there and preaching. And I, sister, I don't mean to embarrass you, but I just sense that something is stirred in you that you just can't quite get it today because you want to get it. And I could say this to probably several of you in here, but the Lord is your keeper. He's your healer. He's your deliverer. And whatever you need Him, whatever you come here seeking for Him today, He said, I'm going to fulfill that wish in you, that longing inside of you. We go from place to place trying to get it fulfilled. I know, young people, I know there's a lot out there. I know there's a lot of places you can go to get filled up with all kind of stuff, and they don't even have names for all of it. They just make them up as they go. But it don't matter, you know, if you got Jesus, you don't even need that stuff. I've been so drunk on the Holy Ghost. I've been so full of the joy of the Lord. I couldn't stand up. I remember one time we were in a revival down in Alabama somewhere, and the power of God just moved in the service, and the Spirit of the Lord was moving, and we went. I think we went out and got a bite to eat as we normally do, and we went back to our motorhome, and I drove up to the motorhome, and boy, I couldn't move. I said, I'm good. I'm real good. But I can't move right now. Sheila took the kids in, got them ready for bed, and they cut the lights out, and I'm sitting there. I just basking in the presence of God. I was so good. You couldn't take a drug to give you that. You couldn't take a medicine to give that to you. You can't take a drink of something to give that to you. You can't party enough to get like that. And I've seen some messed up people, but I was kind of messed up that night. A good way. I didn't have to hug the toilet. I didn't have to wobble around. Oh, I was a little wobbly, but it wasn't because of something I took. It was something I had. Something that was in me become greater than anything around me. And all I wanted to do was just stay right there in it. I didn't want to leave. All you say, well, you could have went on in the house. Well, you don't know what I was going through right there. I don't think I had strength enough to lift my... You ever been slain in the Spirit? I was still up and around, but I was slain in the Spirit. You know, it don't get no better. Well, it does, because I've had it better. It just keeps getting better. Amen? I think there's something that God wants to do in us that causes that spontaneity to be breathed on. The fire of God to become so alive in us that nothing else around us will satisfy. Oh, y'all may not be ready for this yet. Only Jesus can give you contentment, fulfillment, and satisfaction. Galatians 5:22-26. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such there is no law. And they that are Christ's have crucified the flesh with the affections and lusts. If we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. Let us not be desirous of vainglory, provoking one another, envying one another. Amen? My daddy was a provoker at times. We didn't have money, but we had a desire. We'd be driving along. I don't think we ever went out to eat. Growing up, we never went out to eat. I don't have to think about it. I know we didn't go out to eat. But my daddy, we'd go by a hot dog stand. Said, boy, it'd be nice to have one of them hot dogs. We'd know it was coming. It'd be nice to have one of them hot dogs up there, you know, coming down the road. And we get a little closer and we think, oh, this may be the day. This may be the time. And we get a little closer and, oh man, it sure would be good. Put a little mustard, ketchup, and onions, chili, one of them South Carolina hot dogs. Not one of them North New York, up north hot dogs, you know. One of them Coney Islands, one of them real hot dogs. Yeah. A real South Carolina hot dog, you know. Oh, my Lord, have mercy. I could taste one right now. About to drool on this microphone. You know, we get a little closer, and all of a sudden, he starts slowing down. I said, oh, he's going to do it. He's going to do it, man. Come on, Daddy, let's do it. And we get right up there where it's supposed to be turning in. He had mashed the gas all the way to the floor. Oh, maybe next time. Hey, my daddy was a card. He loved to have fun. But that's something that our Heavenly Father would never do to us. You know, that was torture to us kids. My daddy thought it was funny. He just laughed, belly laugh. He thought it was funny. But that was torture. But the Heavenly Father never do you like that. If He shows you something, if He begins to put something desire in you, some desire that you know, you can't fulfill it within yourself, but you just start feeling it, and you start, oh, there's something in me. There's a desire. There's a hunger in me. He won't leave you that way. He will pour into you whatever it takes. He will open His Word to you. He will enlighten you. He will revelize you. He will pour into you and give you something that you can't describe to somebody else. Sometimes I'll be going along and I'll be getting these thoughts and this what I call revelations in my mind. And I look over at Sheila and I say, man, I just had this. And I share, and she's, uh-huh. And I say, well, come on. You ain't got no more than that. That's that it? She said, well, yeah, that's good. Huh? But she didn't get the revelation of it. She heard me repeat it, but she still didn't get the... Sometimes you can hear the Word of God coming forth from the pulpit, but until it gets in you and there becomes a revelation, that light turns on inside of you, that thing that the pastor has said 100 times finally clicks, or you're reading through the Bible and you've read this thing 12 times, and then all of a sudden that light comes on. That enlightenment of God comes into you, and that scripture means more to you at that time than you've ever known before. You see more in that than you've ever. I pray that God turns on a light in your soul, lights a fire in your bosom. He turns on the breath of God, breathes on you, that we get so quickened by the power and the Spirit of God that nothing else satisfies us but Him, His presence, His joy, His power, His glory. I want the glory of God to manifest in here as it did in 2 Chronicles, that we won't even be able to get up here and do nothing. You say, well, you're dreaming. Let me alone if I'm dreaming. I'm going to see it happen. I've seen it in times gone by, and I'll see it again. Remember one service we got in? We were in a little small church down in Louisiana. And we were going to get up and sing some songs, and Sheila hit one chord on the keyboard. And something, the Spirit of God swept over that place, and people began to weep. Hadn't sung a song, hadn't even really played a full a measure of chords, just one chord. And the Spirit of God came in. See, it's not so much about what we do is just a setup. You know, we want to draw you in by the Spirit. We want to draw you in, but we can only do so much by what we do. It has to be God that draws you. And when He does, if you ever, ever, ever get this, a little bit of it. This is a crude illustration, but a friend of mine, John Starnes, is his name. Some of you may have heard that name in years gone by. Great singer. He was out and wanted me to go golfing with him one day. And I never held golf clubs, I don't think, at that time. Maybe a putt-putt, you know. But I got up there and, you know, he said, stand like this and did this. And I swung at that ball and looked. Oh, it's still sitting right there where I swung. I said, man, this game ain't for me. He said, no, just keep trying. If you ever hit one good shot, you'll be hooked. And that's right. Man, I was out there and way on down the field. He talked me into getting the club again, and I took one out. And he said, now stand there, bend your knees just a little bit, you know, and get in position and keep your eye on the ball. Keep your eye on the ball. I can't get down there to it, John. No. Just keep watching it. Keep watching. So I took that thing and I kept my eye on that ball, and I drew back and I swung. And when I hit that thing, I didn't look up for a second, but when I did, that thing was soaring. Woo, Lord! It went 200 yards out there, maybe. At least 150. It felt like 300, man. I was hooked. Now, I don't play golf often, but I had me a hole-in-one story. Ain't very many have that. But I'm telling you, once you... That's a crude illustration. But once you experience God, not the God that somebody told you about, not the God that maybe you even read the book on, once you experience Him in reality, in His glory and power, and His love, shoo, you're a good, good Father. It's who you are. I can't sing it good enough to make you know how good He is. I can't say it good enough to make you know how good He is and how great this thing is. I've got the best thing going. Witness to somebody. Just tell them how good He's been to you. That's all it. All you got to do. If it hits them, and they want it. If they run the other way, they heard something. A seed has been planted in them, and sooner or later, that seed will begin to grow. Amen. Lord Jesus, Sheila, go to the keyboard if you don't mind. It's the best thing. You're the best thing that's ever happened to me. He's so good. This world may try to satisfy that longing in your soul. You may search the wide world over, but you'll just be as before. You'll never find true satisfaction until you found the Lord. Only Jesus can satisfy your soul. Satisfy your soul. Only He can change your heart and make you whole. He'll give you peace you never knew, sweet joy. Oh, and love in heaven too. Would you bow your heads and close your eyes with me? Father, I thank you for your strength, your word. I thank you for blessing my life so many, many times, Lord. I'm so thankful, so grateful for everything you've brought me to and brought me through. I thank you, Lord, that there's people here today and people in the video world that are seeing this, maybe that they don't know you like I know you. They've never had an experience with a loving Father. Lord, I pray that right now by your Spirit, you would reach out to them. Lord, satisfy that hunger and that thirsting in their soul, that void that is so causing them to reach out into multiple places to get fulfillment and to satisfaction, Lord, that only comes from you. I pray, God, that you will move in such a way in their lives, Lord, that they can't doubt it. It's real. It's real. It's real. Make it real to us today, God. If you're here today and you don't know Jesus as your personal Savior, it's not your mama's God. It's not your daddy's God. It's not your cousin's. It's your God that you need to meet and you need to find today. If you don't know Him like that, like I've been talking about Him, if you don't know him yet, you can find Him today. He'll find you. He's already found you, and I believe that He's tugging on your heartstrings right now. And all you have to do is make a commitment today, give your life to Him, give your life to Jesus. Give your life to Jesus, because only He can satisfy you. I want to just stay right here for just a moment. Why don't you just go ahead and stand with us? If you're here and you want to come, I'd love to pray with you. I'd love to pray for you. But I want to pray with you. If you don't know Him today, come. Come now. she's singing this song. If you need prayer today, step out of your seat. We'll agree with you in prayer. If you want prayer, come. We'll pray with you. Several of you sisters don't stand around. You don't mind. You okay with this?
Let me feel your mighty power. Breathe on me, Jesus.
Come on.
Send your spirit this very hour. Like a rushing mighty wind, restore my soul again. Breathe on me, Spirit.
Folks, we ain't going nowhere yet. Spirit of the Lord
this
is upon
is
you.
The air I breathe.
He's called you. He's anointed you.
Your Holy
There's places that you go that I can't go. And you need to go and speak life into those places. But you need to be full of the life of God. You need to be full to overflowing so that when you go to these places that need the life that you have, that their death and their darkness can't get in. If you're full of the Word, like I said before, if we're full of Jesus, if we're full of the Word of God, then nothing outside can come in. Some people say that, oh, Christians can be demon possessed. I don't believe that. That's a lie from the pit of hell. The Spirit of the Lord is upon you. Receive right now what He has. I don't know what He has for you. Sister said she needs prayer. And if you're ready, He's ready. I believe you're ready.
I'm desperate.
Receive.
For you.
Receive. In the name of Jesus. Listening. Thank you for receiving. We thank you, Father. Thank you for listening. And thank you for sending. Thank you for touching lives here today. God, we cover that seed, Lord Jesus, that has been planted in lives today and in hearts today. God, that it will grow infernal soul. I could stay right here. I believe I could stay here all day. I love you, my love, and my love, and my love. You're so precious to me. So precious to me. I love you, Lord. I love you, Lord. Good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. So sweet. So precious. So kind. Sister, you ain't gonna go. You came one way, but you're going away a different person. God did something in you, am I right? Yes, it did.
Hallelujah.
I think it did something in me too. I know it did. I think he did something in several of us here. Hallelujah. There's some of you, I'm going to prophesy to you right now. Some of you have so much gifting inside of you. Some of you, all you got to do is release it. This lady was sitting there last night with a tube of toothpaste, and she said, "You know, this is good for me. But I can speak to it. I can command it. It ain't coming out of that tube. I can pray over it. I can get somebody to agree with me that it's coming out. Come on, Sammy, we need to agree here. And it won't come out until it's squeezed a little bit." Some of y'all have been squeezed. You don't understand why you've been squeezed. It's so the real thing inside of you can come out.
Yes.
So, because it's not just you that's going to change the world. It's what's inside of you.
Yes, yes.
Yeah, we need to pray. We need to read the word. But that what that God put inside of us, that's what's going to make the difference. Amen. I'm quitting. I'm through. God bless you. We love you. Thank you. Next Sunday is a special day. What time are we starting? Same time, 10:30? Okay. All right. He'll give you more definition on the one call, I'm sure. Did anybody get a one call this weekend? No, I didn't either. We're going to have to talk to him. No, I'm kidding. I know he's busy down there. But we love you. Pray for your pastor this week. God gives him great time there, and Traveling Mercy's back. Pray for us as we go back to our home. And I love you. Thank you. Bless you. You're blessed and highly favored of the Lord. Amen.